Welcome. So today I just want to go over kind of the process of how do you build your project up from the ground, describing each of the different activities. How do you deal with predecessors when you're dealing with scheduling, creating a network diagram, how to estimate time durations for each component. These are all interrelated topics. And yes, we've got lectures on the things individually. I just kind of want you to see from start to finish kind of how this process works. So as you can see here, I have just a general spreadsheet with a list of activities, A through H, that I've already created. I also have a description for each activity. And so this could be whatever you want. So we have something where we're signing a contract, then we're designing a questionnaire, we're identifying a target market, conducting surveys, developing a presentation, analyzing some data, and so on. Now, in a perfect world, if these were all in series, then we would not have to do any of these types of processes. However, we want to get things done in a little bit more efficient manner. When we have more people, we can do things in parallel. So we need to specify, before we do much of anything else, is what the predecessors are. In other words, which activities have to occur before the following activity. And it's only the one that's immediately following that concerns us. So for B and for C, to design a questionnaire and identify target market, maybe we have to have the contract signed before we're even going to start this whole process. Say we're doing this for a client. So in either of these cases, we want to make sure that A is the predecessor, right? Activity A. Now, this makes sense when we're specifying which activity. When we look later on, when we talk about Microsoft Project or Project Libre, you actually specify the line number that it's on. So in other words, instead of having A's here, I would have line 6 in those types of projects for predecessors. Okay, so now for D, let's say D can't happen until we've got both of these things ready. So we got to figure out, well, who are we going to ask the survey questions? And this questionnaire has to be designed. So D really requires B and C to be done. So this has two predecessors. So B, C tells us that, well, both these things have to be done before we can go on. What about E, to develop a presentation? Well, maybe we can do this in parallel with some other things while the survey is happening. So maybe the only thing that's really required is B to happen. So we'll throw in B as, not C. Smarter than we want it to be. Let's say for analyzing data, this has to come after the survey. So maybe this only requires D. So we put D. Analyzing demographic data. Well, that actually comes right after we identify which market we're looking at. We don't have to wait for the other data to come out. So this only relies on C. And when we're all done to present the customer, well, we probably need the presentation done, all the analysis done. So it probably requires E, F, and G. Okay. All right, the other things that we can calculate here is our duration. So if you looked at the lecture before, we use the beta distribution. And with the beta distribution, we have our optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic values. Optimistic usually aligns with variable A, most likely is variable M. Pessimistic is variable B. And so we need to estimate these times. So this is, the optimistic is always the shortest amount of time you think it can be, that you can possibly do this type of activity. And let's say these are weeks, because that's our duration. So we think we can do in 2 weeks the whole process of negotiating and signing a contract. Most likely, it's probably going to be 3 weeks. If it really takes us a long time and a lot of things we have to hash out, it's probably going to be 4 weeks. That's our pessimistic estimate. Now, these things don't have to be balanced. However, your most likely definitely has to be between these two because it's somewhere in between. And so this is where it deviates from a normal curve. How do we calculate the time estimate then? Well, it's essentially an average, but it's a weighted average. So it's the optimistic value plus 4 times the most likely value plus the pessimistic value. So if you notice, we're really weighting where the median is by 4 times. And so if we were to add all these up, because really we have four E6s and these two, it's dividing by six. So it really looks just like an average when you calculate that. Now, this is the same calculation for each and every activity. So this gives us our TEs for all the activities. Now, if we want to look at these, we actually probably want to round these up when we're talking about weeks. Now, we could use it in its raw terms, but we could round it. And that's what I would typically do. If you're going to put these into nodes, you use the roundup variable. You also need to do the variance. So, and that is B minus A over 6 squared. So it is the B value, the pessimistic value, minus the optimistic value, divided by 6. And we need to square that whole thing. Parentheses around that. Use the hat 2, that's R squared. Voila. These, we don't need to have that much fidelity. Two significant digits is usually fine. You can go with 3 if you like. And then now I'm copying all this down to fill down. So now we have all of our variance values. We'll save this for later. What I want to show you now is then how do we use this data once we have the predecessors so that we can figure out what goes where. Because I want to draw a network diagram. And I want to show you how to do it manually first. So we had our activity A, B, C, D, H. And B required. These are activities, predecessors, kind of creating the same thing. So maybe I can show this in a split screen so you can see both. It's a little bit hard because I've got everything already tabulated here, so I'd rather not draw all that out again. So if you can look down here, so I know A is what I start with, so that'll be my activity A. Activity A. B and C require A, so these can be in parallel. Because they can be in parallel, I'm going to spread them apart. B up here, C down there. I could use the names, but it's fine just to use those things. D actually required B and C, so this is a merging activity. Notice this is a burst activity on A, and then D is a merge activity because things are coming back together with that. E only requires B, so I'll bring that up here. G only requires C. Right? And F only required D, the way we had it set up. And again, your network is going to be entirely determined by that list of predecessors that we have up here on the spreadsheet. And of course, H required E, F, and G, so it has to come after all three of those. And so then, again, H is a merge activity. Great. This is what our network diagram looks like. And if you notice, we have several parallel things going on at different cases. So we could have E, D, and G going out at the same time, or E, F, and G going out at the same time, B and C at the same time, all sorts of different things. Now, the estimates, then, are the time estimates. So for A, we came up with a duration of 3 weeks. For B, we had a duration of 4, so that goes down in the middle there. For C, 6.33. If I want to be conservative, I can go up. I can go up to 7. Now, you may say, well, why don't I round down? You could round down. However, if you're trying to be conservative and give yourself a buffer, you can always round up, and that gives you a little bit of extra time. Unless you're in a really competitive bidding scenario, usually that's a safe bet. All right, so D is 13 on the dot. E is 3.8333, so we'll call that a 4. And then F has 4.333, so we'll call that 5. G, 7.8, and so on, that's an 8. H, 2.166, really close to 2, but heck, we'll go conservative again, 3. And there you have it. You actually have now created your network diagram by hand. So the next thing I'm going to want to show you guys is then how to do your forward and backward passes on a diagram like this.